little different. I'm going to go over my Mark 18 setup. I got a lot of buddies asking me questions on how to set up their rifles, newer people getting into shooting, stuff like that. So I want to go over some mindset stuff and just a little overview of the Danger Defense Mark 18. So let's get right into it. So number one question I get whenever you're setting up a new rifle is going to be, what do I need for a beginner gun? Bare minimum budget rifle. I always tell people two things. You need a light and you need some way of shooting a gun, whether that be irons, red dot, whatever. Those are the most important things, other than, of course, ammo, because you need to train a whole bunch. That's a big thing. And magazines for your gun too. You don't want to have three or four magazines. You want to have a good stockpile. So for my light right now, I'm running just a Surefire. I think it's Attack Pro. I can't remember which one it is. It's the longer one. It's not the shorter one. I didn't want to spend money on Surefire. It just didn't seem to make sense for my application. So this one's perfectly bright. One thing I hate about it is it has a strobe feature. So if you double tap the pressure pad on top right there, it ends up strobing. I'm not a big fan of strobe lights. It destroys your natural night vision. But then again, there's an argument for it'll destroy your opponent's natural night vision too. So not a terrible thing. You can live with it for sure. But when you get it, it comes with everything you need to set it up on the gun. It'll come with the mount. It'll come with a pigtail and a pressure switch, which has a momentary on and constant on button to the rear. So I have that mounted to the 12 o'clock position up top. And then for the optics on this rifle, I'm running Knights Armament iron sights. The rear sight's just off an M16 from the Marines. It's Marine marked. And the front's just a CAC front sight. It's kosher for the Mark 18s for the front sight. I'm not sure about the rear sight, but I got a good deal on them, so I slapped them on here. They work perfect for what I need. So if you're wanting to go red dot option or magnified optic option, that's a whole other story. Right now I'm running an EOTech EXPS2 on here. It's the non-night vision compatible version. Fun fact, all EOTechs are night vision compatible. They just won't have different brightness settings for night vision. So you can run this with night vision. I used to have a PBS-14. Ran it with this, super easy. So those are the main two things you need to get when you're setting up a new rifle, because the light, you need to be able to shoot in the dark. That's a big thing. You can't shoot what you can't see, and optics are huge too. Optics or irons are huge too, because if you can't aim, what's the point? So that's the main stuff. The other stuff on here isn't really necessary. It helps me shoot a lot better, and as time goes on, you'll figure stuff out. So, now that we got that out of the way, we're just going to go tip to butt. And again, this firearm has been safety cleared before. No magazine in. I've already checked the chamber, so we're good there. So, on the tip of the gun, I have a Surefire 3-prong. Great, great flash hider. Shoot at night quite a bit. Not a very recognizable muzzle signature. Obviously, you're going to get something, but it's not the fireball that this 10.3-inch barrel would put out regularly. That's a great thing, and I'm planning on getting a Surefire can for it too. So this does have a QD area, so you can attach your suppressor on it. Good to go, rocks for me. Big fan of Surefire muzzle devices. Again, the light, already went over that. It's the Surefire Protec 2. I can't remember the exact model again. Works great for what I need. If I had the money for it, I would get a Surefire just because they have a little bit better wrap. But if you're on a budget, it's like $100 on Amazon, so it's not going to break the bank at all. Up top for iron sights, again, the Knights Armament set. I didn't say before, but they are fairly expensive. You can get lucky and find some surplus. The front sight came with this receiver whenever I bought it. I bought this upper receiver secondhand. No problems with it, but I got lucky and it came with that. So great irons there. Moving to the bottom rail, I have a Magpul AFG2. So technically, this is an AR pistol. This is a pistol brace, not a stock. Thank you, ATF. But you cannot have a 90-degree foregrip on your pistol, your AR pistol. That makes it a short-barreled rifle. The AFGs are great. I've always used them a little bit here and there, but for my shooting stance, it's I don't want to say a C-clamp, but it's thumb over bore so I can actuate my pressure pad. That AFG works great for me. So moving on back, I have a just an Amazon QD sling mount right here. Works great for me, haven't had any issues. But yeah, it keeps the sling out of the way up front where I need it. Works good for me. Also, that brings me to another point, slings. Slings are huge for your guns. It keeps the rifle to you, as T-Rex Arms says. I love Lucas. He's putting out a lot of great content, great products. Go check out Lucas. I'll probably put a link to his page in the description. But yeah, the sling is very important. So you don't want something that's going to hinder your manipulation of the weapon. You want the weapon to work around you. So that's a big deal when picking out a sling. This sling I'm using right now is the Viking Tactics, just a two-point sling. I have QDs on here on the front and the rear of the weapon. It is adjustable tension, so if you're not using it, you can tighten it down to your body so you can do whatever else you need to do. When you're using it, you can loosen it up a little bit. Great sling, been running it for about 3-4 years now. No complaints there. Great, great sling. And it's pretty cheap too. I believe they're around 50-60 bucks on Amazon. So another sling I'd go with is the T-Rex Arms. It's about 55 bucks. Same concept, you tighten it and loosen it. Love that sling too. The Ferro Concept Slingster is another good one. It's getting a little bit more expensive. That one's a very comfortable sling too. It has a very thick shoulder pad for you. So, all right, moving on back. Talked about it already, EOTech XPS 2. Great optic, love it, absolutely love it. No complaints whatsoever about it. Haven't had any issues, no fogging in the cold weather, going from hot to cold or cold to hot. So I've been very, very pleased with this. The reticle's super bright, very recognizable, and you have that donut of death too, which is super sweet in there. So moving on back, we have the Radian Raptor charging handle. So I am left-handed. I don't need a whole bunch of ambi stuff. You shouldn't either. My philosophy behind that was I wanted to be able to shoot on a stock AR-15 or M4 base. And as I progress in my shooting, then I can start mixing in some of the ambi parts just to kind of get used to it. So in that case, I do have to use someone else's rifle. I'm very well acquainted with a right-handed setup predominantly. But this charging handle is great. It's got the lip on the back because this is a gassy gun. It's a very, very gassy gun. This lip on the back here prevents some gas coming out and getting in your face. And it's really hard to shoot when you got gas in your eyes. It makes you cry. So that helps out a lot. Big, huge wings on here. Again, it's ambidextrous, so you can grab it from either side. Works great. Super light, too. Very, very strong. I've had to mortar a couple rifles with Radians in them. No issue with them breaking or bending there. So big fan of the Radian Raptors. So on the back of the rifle, I'm running the SBA-3 pistol brace. I like this a lot better than the SBA-4s or the blades or anything like that, just because its size. This is most familiar to a rifle stock for me. So big fan of the SBA-3s. You get a lot of area on the back here to put it in your shoulder, because you are allowed to do that apparently now, if the ATF ever makes up their mind. It is adjustable as well. You have all six positions there. So great, great, great pistol brace. This rubber band right here, I see a lot of people with them on their butt stocks, and I ask them a lot of times, hey, what's that rubber band for? I'd say about 70% of the time, they have no idea. They saw it in Call of Duty, looked cool. Hey, I'll put a rubber band in my gun. This is for sling retention. So if I'm running this gun in a vehicle-borne operation or whatever, I'm going to tuck my sling underneath this rubber band, keep it out of the way, and I do it in a manner where I can still operate the rifle with the sling attached. When I'm ready for the sling to go, rip it right out of the rubber band, and we're ready to rock and roll. So this is just a really, really basic setup. Here's the big deal too. Do not set your rifle up because this looks cool. You need to have a purpose for everything on your gun, and that purpose changes for everybody, okay? And I was guilty of that. I started out trying to clone one of Grand Thumb's Mark 18s. Didn't work for me because I'm not Grand Thumb. So make your rifle your own. go out and shoot. That's the only way you're going to find out what you need, what you don't need. So that's a big, big issue of mine right there. Do not clone someone else's rifle. Make the rifle your own. Make sure everything has a purpose on it. Okay? All right, so that's the overview. Let's go over this rifle real quick. This upper receiver in particular, because the lower is just an Anderson, a poverty pony. Works great for me, no problems. So, the actual Mark 18 upper. This is a Savannah, Georgia marked rail on here. It's an older upper. It's not the new generation's, or it has Daniel Defense Mark 18 on this side right here. It does have some trades. Up front, it's got Daniel Defense. That's about it. So, I can't remember what years this was from, but I've put, 4,000 or 5,000 rounds on this gun so far. And the previous owner shot a good amount with it too. I couldn't get a specific number from him, but my round count's been around 4,000 or 5,000 rounds. No issues whatsoever. Only issues I've had are for me not operating the gun correctly and looking like an idiot, which happens. And magazines. I've had a couple issues with magazines, just GI magazines, where I forgot to change the spring out on them and having some feeding problems there. Great upper receiver, built like a tank. The rail's built like a tank too. Bulk carrier group, not seeing any weird wearing on that. It looks great after those rounds I put through it. So I will say this though. A lot of people are dogging on the 10.3 barrel length. They're saying 11.5 is the lowest you need to go. So when this upper receiver set was submitted to SOCOM, they were intending to put a suppressor on the end. And contrary to popular belief in video games, suppressors do help out a little bit with muzzle velocity. It doesn't make your damage go down. Don't worry about that. So my gripe is I shoot this gun up to 600 meters all the time. So as far as stopping power goes, it's still getting to the target fast. And this is a very, very, very dumb, amateur, non-scientific gripe. And I'm still hitting targets at 600 meters. Holding with the EOTech recommended holds. So I really don't see the big deal there. I wouldn't go shorter than this though. That's whenever you start seeing dramatic muzzle velocity changes. But I will say, don't knock it till you try it with the 10.3. If you have an option to get an 11.5, great, do it. Obviously, the longer barrel length, the better muzzle velocity you're getting, and the better ballistics you're going to get out of that 5.56. It was designed to be shot out of a 20-inch barrel. So, with that in mind, there are special ammunition types for the shorter barrels. I can't remember off the top of my head, but there's several rounds designed specifically for the Mark 18 that have amazing ballistics. They're just extremely expensive and super hard to get a hold of. So, in saying that, I don't shy away from the Mark 18 whatsoever. I don't think it's as outdated as people are claiming it is. So altogether, this is not a beginner setup whatsoever. This cost me quite a bit of money, and that sucks. But at the end of the day, I got a cool toy, and it works great for me for what I need it to do. In conclusion, what you need to take away from this video is when you buy your first gun, or you're getting into shooting, and you want a rifle or an AR pistol. You do not need all this stuff. Biggest thing for you is ammo. You need ammo to shoot. You need to shoot to train. Get out there and shoot your guns. That's the only way you're going to be a better shooter. And that is a big deal. So, first things you need to get for your new rifle. Definitely a flashlight. Definitely some way to shoot your gun. So, optics. Whether it be iron sights or a red dot. This gun cost me a lot of money that I did not need to spend to get something like this, but I wanted a Mark 18, so I went on and bit the bullet and built this. So, guys, get out and shoot. Don't spend all your money on cool stuff to make your rifle look cool and then suck at shooting. That's a big deal. So, thank you guys for tuning in, and we'll catch you in the next one.